Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. Can I remind members that questions 2 and 7 are grouped, and that I'll take any supplementaries on these questions after both have been answered. And at question number 1, I call Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how the latest Building a New Scotland paper advances its prospectus for independence.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Our latest paper, Creating a Modern Constitution for an Independent Scotland, sets out proposals for a written constitution that puts democracy, rights and equality at the heart of everything we do as an independent country. Only with the powers of independence can we create a constitution for Scotland and fully recognise and protect the fundamental rights of people in Scotland. As with all the prospectus material, this publication delivers on our commitment to give the people the information they need to make an informed choice about whether Scotland should become an independent country.
Jackie Dunbar.
I thank the Minister for that answer. These papers lay out a bold and comprehensive vision for Scotland's transition to independence, ensuring that the debate over our new Scotland is frank, open and well-informed. Yet the UK Government continues to ignore the cast-iron democratic mandate for this Parliament to hold our referendum. Indeed, Westminster is actively undermining devolution by blocking progressive legislation and imposing cruel policies like those in the Illegal Migration Bill. Will the Minister reassert the will of this Parliament and the Scottish people to his UK counterparts, not only for the opportunity to build a new Scotland, but to safeguard Scottish democracy itself?
Yeah. Minister. Yeah.
Well, I certainly will reassert that. There is a very clear pattern of ongoing interference in devolved matters by the UK government, routinely ignoring the constitutional conventions that we have in place about the UK not normally legislating for devolved issues. That in itself is a salient reminder of the limitations of not having a codified constitution. We will continue to press the point that devolution shouldn't be rode roughshod over, but it is only with independence, of course, that we can truly protect the people of Scotland from the damaging and undemocratic UK government decisions being inflicted here in Scotland.
Question number 2, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of the publication of the latest paper in the Building of New Scotland series, for what reasons it considers that an independent Scotland would need a written constitution?
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
The Scottish Government believes an independent Scotland should have a written modern constitution, set out clearly in one place our fundamental values as a nation, the rules for how our country would be governed, and the rights and protections for the people who live here. Almost every country around the world has a codified constitution. A written constitution for an independent Scotland will show the world the type of country we will be.
Karen Adam.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Scotland's written constitution, as set out in the new paper, would safeguard people in Scotland from having their human rights and workers' rights swept away following a simple parliamentary majority, just as we are watching happen before our very eyes with the UK government. Can the Minister explain how a written constitution would be better protecting the rights of the citizens in an independent Scotland?
Minister.
Well, the answer is inherent within the question that Karen Adam has asked me, because what we proposes a written constitution that provides a special status for the most important laws, the fundamental issues around the rights and civil liberties and equalities for people, providing safeguards in that respect, ensuring that if the constitution was to be changed, it has to reach a higher threshold than a simple parliamentary majority. That's the limitation of the unwritten, uncodified UK constitution, because that's what's happening right now, and we're seeing things like the Human Rights Act under threat as a consequence.
Question number 7, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of its latest Building a New Scotland paper, what its position is on how a written constitution could protect democracy, the sovereignty of the people, freedom and the rule of law in an independent Scotland.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
A constitution for an independent Scotland would mark the end of Westminster parliamentary sovereignty in Scotland. Creating a new written constitution would establish Scotland as an independent, modern, democratic state, shifting where power lies by replacing Westminster sovereignty with the sovereignty of the people who live here in Scotland. A written constitution for independent Scotland would protect the fundamental elements of Scotland's democracy and the rights of people in the country by giving them a higher status than ordinary laws. Individual governments would not then use a simple parliamentary majority to undermine key institutions or water down fundamental human rights, as is happening now in the UK Parliament.
Ruth Maguire.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Sovereignty of the people is a proud tradition in Scots law, but it's clearer now more than ever that it's a tradition that's simply not upheld as part of the UK with a dominant Westminster Parliament. Can the Minister lay out just how transformative it would be for our citizens to have a written constitution which transfers power to the people in an independent Scotland?
Minister.
Well, Ms Maguire is entirely right, of course. Our proposals would re-establish the historic Scots constitutional tradition that the people are sovereign here in Scotland. And we should remind ourselves of the ruling of the Court of Session in 1953 that the principle of unlimited sovereignty of Parliament is a distinctively English principle and has no counterpart in Scottish constitutional law. So under our proposals, the people of Scotland would be central to the decision-making process with a range of opportunities to get involved and influence the development of the Constitution. And then our proposals would allow people in Scotland to hold future governments of an independent Scotland to account and ensure that key human rights and equality protections are upheld. That's in stark contrast with the limitations of devolution right now.
Question number 3, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how its international development work is supporting the connections between humanitarian aid and loss and damage.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Our humanitarian emergency fund provides support to tackle the immediate impact of humanitarian crisis, including to climate-related disasters such as the devastating floods in Pakistan. We are also using our initial £2 million loss and damage to support communities to address losses and damages in the Global South and further research on needs assessments and case studies. We acknowledge the close links between the humanitarian assistance and loss and damage as an issue explored in the recent Practical Action for Addressing Loss and Damage report, which followed the International Loss and Damage Conference hosted by the Scottish Government in October 2022.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for that response. Extreme weather events and events like droughts and sea level rise are intensifying. This means that the Humanitarian Emergency Fund is going to become increasingly important for disaster relief. But that fund and other support like the Climate Justice Fund, which I know falls under another portfolio, must be structured in ways that enable the links between humanitarian development, resilience and peace activities. Can the Minister outline what, if any, plans there are to expand the Humanitarian Emergency Fund? And will she commit to exploring and keeping pace with international discussions on those links between humanitarian development, resilience and peace work?
Minister.
The close links between humanitarian development, resilience, peace are equally recognised. And as I've indicated, our humanitarian fund provides support to tackle the immediate impact of humanitarian crisis. Yesterday, I announced £250,000 of funding from our humanitarian emergency fund for projects to provide food, access to clean water and shelter to people affected by the violent conflict in Sudan. In terms of our contribution on longer-term resilience and peace, we also separately fund our Women in Conflict 1325 Fellowship Programme to meet our commitment on UN Security Council Resolution 1325, Women, Peace and Security.
Donald Cameron.
Thank you. With regards to the Scottish Government's international development work on loss and damage and more widely, is the Minister convinced that, given resources are obviously limited, that the funding and the work is happening in the right parts of the world, especially given that some parts of the Global South are not currently covered?
Minister.
Yes, I am convinced, but we always maintain a review approach to these matters because we see some of the clearest indications of climate change and the loss and damage that comes with that across many of the areas in the world, particularly in the Global South. And we currently have a Global South panel whom I meet with often to ensure that we are focusing our resources in the right way, at the right time and for the right reasons.
Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While loss and damage is a really important funding, can the Minister say what the Scottish Government is doing to work with the banking and financial sector in Edinburgh, given the impact of debt on low-income countries can absolutely hold them back from both mitigating and adapting to climate change?
Minister.
What I can do for Sarah Boyack for that really important question is to discuss it with the Cabinet Minister who has responsibility for the loss and damage and the justice, Climate Justice Fund, and come back to Sarah Boyack with a clearer answer on the work that's been been done with banks and others. I know that the World Bank is an organisation that we've been working with in many of these matters, but I'll get her the most up-to-date details on that.
Question number four, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting culture and the arts in the Uddingston and Belsill constituency.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Our culture strategy sets out our ambitions for nurturing culture and creativity across all of Scotland's communities. We are supporting a range of individuals, organisations and projects across the Uddingston and Bells Hill constituency via Creative Scotland, including the Culture Collective Programme and the Youth Music Initiative Programme. For example, through the Culture Collective Programme, the North Lanarkshire Collective received over £238,000 to develop six creative arts projects anchored by six community organisations, including Orbison Neighbourhood Centre in Bellshill.
Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Artists and cultural producers are key to promoting diversity, yet the representation of disabled artists in creative industries is described as woefully small. And barriers can include a lack of knowledge around disabled access requirements, and a lack of awareness of disabled artists' work often hinders their professional development. So can I ask the Minister, what action can the Scottish Government take to ensure investment made in the arts and culture sector creates inclusive opportunities for disabled artists, particularly for those located out with the main cities?
Minister.
Yeah, thanks very much for that question. I think as a former Equalities Minister, I hope Stephanie Callaghan will realise that I'm very mindful of the challenges faced. And the Scottish Government's ambition is to halve the disability employment gap in Scotland by 2038. And on the 19th of December, we published a refreshed Fair Work Action Plan, which includes a focus on disabled people's employment. Our culture strategy sets out our ambition for people across Scotland to lead a cultural life of their choice, including as artists and creative practitioners, regardless of their ability. Creative Scotland worked with partners to enable Scottish participation in the UK-wide Unlimited programme, which commissions artworks from disabled artists. Funding has included support to artists based at Eden Court in Inverness and Ann Tober and Mull Theatre.
Thank you. Question number five, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it has provided to cultural activities in Midlothian South, Tweeddale and Lauderdale constituency.
Minister Christina McKellar.
As I mentioned in my response to Stephanie Callaghan, the Scottish Government supports a range of cultural activities and communities across the whole of Scotland. We also provide targeted support for culture through our funding to local authorities and public bodies, including Creative Scotland, who support many cultural activities in the Midlothian South, Tweeddale and Lauderdale region. For example, via Creative Scotland, we have recently provided Youth Music Initiative funding to the Where's the One programme in the Scottish Borders to provide a programme of music-making activities for young carers.
Christine Graham.
Thank the Minister for her answer, and I very much, put on the record, I very much welcome the Scottish Government investment in the great tapestry of Scotland and Gala Shields. But is the Minister aware that former Gala Shields weaver Robert Coulthart was the author of perhaps a world-first advertising jingle, Ali Bally Bee, to sell his Coulter's candy? No singing, please. Would the Scottish Government be supportive, and I'm not seeking cash, so you can relax, Minister, of a small and humble museum dedicated to this intriguing and mischievous man, perhaps near where we already have an excellent statue to him in Gala Shields?
Minister.
Yeah, I was going to sing Ali Bally, Ali Bally Bee, but I'll save you the trauma. Presiding Officer, there is no doubt in the cultural significance of Robert Coulthard's song. Everybody knows it, and I know you're all singing it in your heads now, aren't you? The song about Coulter's candy. It's a song that's sung in communities across all of Scotland and shared across generations, not just in Gala. But Gala is also now the home of the Great Tapestry of Scotland, and it's great to see that the improvements and the wealth and the tourism that brings to Gala. For Christine Graham's main question, we welcome and encourage any exploration and celebration of our heritage. While we cannot guarantee any funding, as she knows, from Scottish Government or our partners, she may find it helpful to contact Museums and Galleries Scotland, who provide development and funding on our behalf, for advice, support, as you explore opportunities to tell Robert Coulthard's story. And maybe if she sang her pitch to Museums and Galleries Scotland, it may give her application an edge.
Question number six, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to support the constitutional protection of the specific interests and needs of island communities as outlined in the latest Building a New Scotland paper.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Our proposals would enshrine rights contained in the Island Scotland Act 2018 into the Constitution, ensuring the needs of the people who live in our islands are carefully considered when legislation or other decisions of state are being considered. By including them in the Constitution, we would ensure that governments with a simple majority in Parliament will not be able to water down or overturn the rights set out in the Island Scotland Act 2018.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the Minister for that response, but does he not agree that it's an absolute insult to say that it will protect the interests of island communities, given his track record in government, with islanders being forced to write to the Transport Minister after CalMac's failing ferry service has cost businesses on two islands almost £1.5 million, prompting islanders to stage a series of protests on the mainland. All that while we have the ongoing fiasco at Ferguson Marine.
Minister.
No, I don't think it's an insult. I certainly would recognise, and Fiona Hislop, it was on television this morning, the impact that the delays and disruption that have regrettably seen have had on our island communities. Of course, we are committed to working to improve on that, and that has involved the buying and deploying of an additional vessel on the MV Loch Fraser, chartering the MV Arrow to provide additional resilience capacity, commissioning two new vessels for Islay, commissioning two new vessels for the Little Minch routes and other activity. The fundamental proposition here, though, is that we would enshrine, recognising that there are over 90 islands in Scotland which are populated, people living them, real lives, recognising their importance to Scotland, we would enshrine their rights in a written constitution, in a written form. So the question was posed to me, but the question to Finlay Carson and other Tory colleagues is, what special constitutional protection do they propose for Scotland's island communities? Because right now, it looks an awful like the answer is none.
Thank you. And to Alistair Allen.
While it's not a great surprise to know that the Tories oppose plans to increase people's rights, constitutional or otherwise, does the Minister agree that there are neighbouring countries we can look to for examples, and while they are not analogous situations, the Åland Islands in Finland, or the Faroe Islands in Denmark have their own roles codified in constitutions, and that's something we could learn from.
Minister.
Yeah, I absolutely do think we should. And everything we do in our provisions of and proposals for a written constitution, we should be learning from other progressive countries that have considered these matters. And what I can say is that in taking forward our consideration of these matters, having a proposal for a constitutional convention to consider a permanent constitution, it will be essential that the voices of Scotland's island communities are absolutely heard as part of that process.
Question number 8, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the total cost of its Building a New Scotland papers, including civil servants' time and printing costs.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
The cost of the first three papers in Building a New Scotland series have been published on the Scottish Parliament website. The cumulative total for the publication of those is £45,654.66. To be precise, at this time the costs for the fourth publication are still to be received, but as with previous publications, we'll make those costs available in due course.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as usual, the Scottish Government doesn't answer the substantive question, which was all the cost, including civil servants' time. Now, the Cabinet Secretary will know that in my mailbox, the main issues addressed across the Highlands are to deal with duelling the A9 and the A96, delivering the ferries, building Inverness Prison, resolving the A&E crisis at Ragmore, reducing the long orthopaedic waiting list. Funnily enough, our First Minister had a responsibility in ensuring that those were delivered and failed to do so. So my question to you, given the current huge problems that face the Highlands and Islands, surely you should be dealing with these before talking about independence and wasting time on a constitution.
Minister.
Well, unlike Mr Mountain, this government's well capable of dealing with more than one thing at one time. The issues that he has raised, the issues that he has raised are, of course, important, and we will work to them. But given his question was about the cost of the activity we are undertaking, I wonder if he would reflect on the fact that Westminster's self-titled Union Unit has spent nearly £1.5 million on spin doctors, communication staff alone. So if that's the standard that they'll set, I'll reflect happily on the cost efficiency that we are working to.
Kenneth Gibson.
Officer, Scotland and a majority of MSPs in all parties voted overwhelmingly against Brexit, which was subsequently imposed upon us. This necessitated the recruitment of additional civil servants to deal with the impact. Can the Minister provide an update on the total cost to this Parliament of Brexit, including civil servants' time and printing costs?
Understanding orders, it is important. Standing orders requires that questions relate to the substantive question on the order paper, and in this instance I would suggest that that is not the case. Therefore, we will move on to the next portfolio, which is Justice and Home Affairs. Can I remind members that questions 2 and 8 and 4 and 7 are grouped, and any supplementaries on these questions after the grouped questions, they'll be taken at that point. I'll just allow a moment till front benches arrange themselves. We move to Justice and Home Affairs, and at question number one, I call Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what facilities the recently opened HMP Stirling will provide to ensure the rehabilitation of female prisoners upon release.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, I have seen firsthand this new world-leading facility which began bringing women into its care early last week, and it is the third new facility built for women in the past year. It will offer offending behaviour programmes, therapeutic interventions and wellbeing activities. It will also deliver a range of work and learning opportunities that will not only enhance literacy skills but improve the employability prospects for women. This transformative and innovative approach to women in custody will address their specific needs to better prepare them for returning to their families and communities and helping to reduce reoffending.
Evelyn Tweed.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Currently, female prisoners who require high, secure mental health care need to be moved to facilities which are a great distance from their families. How does the Scottish Government intend to support these individuals to maintain relationships with family and friends to break the cycle of generational trauma?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, notwithstanding the significant improvements in the women's custody estate, I want to be clear that prisons are not hospitals for women with acute mental health needs. As a former hospital and prison social worker, I know the difference between the types and appropriate care that can and should be delivered in each setting. And I want to assure the member that myself and health ministers are focused on the right treatment at the right time. In the right place. In terms of the cross-border transfers, the member may know that ministers have a role in authorising these. If there's a request for a patient to move from a hospital in Scotland to a hospital out with Scotland, prior to authorisation of any transfer, specific considerations have to be given to the impact of the proposed transfer, for example, on family relationships and proposals for mitigating that impact. And, of course, local health boards have to consider providing family members, carers, with financial assistance for visits.
Katie Clark.
Thank you. There are fewer alternatives to custody available to women than for men. What steps is the Scottish Government taking to develop alternatives to custody for women, including with a rehabilitation focus, and to develop more forms of supervised bail for women?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I think over the years that alternative to custody services that are specific to the needs of women have indeed improved. There is a much more sophisticated approach, shall we say, to unpaid labour. That would probably be the most obvious example. It is important to remember that in terms of a community payback order, that in terms of the supervision and support that can be built into that can be very individualised and tailor-made. But it is a fair point that the member makes and that is one we will continue to have a very sharp focus on.
Question number two, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the publication Recorded Crime in Scotland 2022-23.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the latest statistics show that Scotland remains a safe place to live, with recorded crime remaining at one of the lowest levels since 1974, down 42% since 2006-07. This includes reductions in crimes involving violence, damage and reckless behaviour. We recognise the impact caused to people who are victims of crime and that while significant progress is being made, there is more we need to do to reduce the harm caused. In particular, we are taking robust action to tackle sexual offending and are focusing on prevention, reducing reoffending and targeting the underlying causes of crime.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. It's very welcome to see recorded crime at one of its lowest levels in 50 years. We know that despite the increasing confidence which people have about reporting domestic abuse and sexual offences, these do remain categories of crime which go seriously underreported. So can I ask what can be done to increase the number of people who feel able to come forward with these complaints?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I know Dr Allen has been a big champion of tackling antisocial behaviour in his constituency, and he makes a very important point that we need to ensure that everyone has the confidence and the ability to report incidents of criminal activity to the police. It is also necessary to fully understand the basis for not choosing to report an incident and to respond accordingly. The figures published this week demonstrate that our approach to justice in Scotland is the right one, but there are always clearly more to do. And we are always working to enhance our relationships with the public, along with our justice partners, and we will carefully consider what more we can and should be doing to respond to local concerns for every community in Scotland.
Question number eight, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the latest recorded crime in Scotland statistics, which shows an increase in the overall level of crime in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as I just said in my answer to Dr Allen, these statistics show that Scotland remains a safe place to live, with recorded crime remaining at one of the lowest levels since 1974, down 42% since 2006-07. Despite this progress, there is more we need to do. That's why we're taking robust action to tackle sexual offending and are redoubling our efforts on prevention, reducing offending and tackling the underlying causes of crime.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. When these recorded crime statistics were published, the Cabinet Secretary boasted that they showed that Scotland continues to be a safe place to live. Crimes under the Domestic Abuse Act are at their highest level since the law came into effect, Cabinet Secretary, and crimes of rape and attempted rape are at their highest level ever. Therefore, does the Cabinet Secretary not think that victims of these crimes should say that Scotland is a safe place to live?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I would take issue of the member's characterisation of a government press release put out in my name. I'm not known for boasting. I do think it is reasonable for the government, when we are looking at recorded crime, that we can, of course, report and we're held to account not just on the short-term trends, but also the long-term trends, and that we are also looking at other sources of information as well, not just recorded crime, but the Criminal Justice Survey that looks at non-reported crimes as well, and as well as the reduction in hospital admissions and the reduction of homicide. So there is much that has indeed improved to make Scotland a safer place. And of course, in terms of members of the public, people do report to feeling safer. Nonetheless, there are particular challenges in and around sexual offending, particular challenges in and around rape, and particular challenges in and around domestic abuse. And as we move forward, I hope, marching together, I look forward to the Member's scrutiny and his support for our Victim, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill.
Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Sexual crimes have increased by 70% since 2013 to 2014. The number of rapes, attempted rapes and crimes under the Domestic Abuse Act are all at their highest levels on record. And sickening, more than a third of sexual assault victims are under 18. This is the harsh reality of the SNP's soft-touch approach to criminal justice. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that these figures point to complacency within the government's approach to justice? And if not, what does she ascribe this abhorrent rise to?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I regret that the Member feels it's appropriate to weaponise sexual offending, and I would also, with respect, point to the Member in terms of that she may well be very tough on rhetoric, but her contribution today, I think, is very soft on substance. We do know that despite the very small reduction in the last year in terms of sexual crime, that we do continue very much to see that long-term growth in reported cases. This, of course, is on the backdrop of heavily under-reporting. And, of course, the latest crime survey suggests that over a fifth of those experiencing forced sexual activity are reporting this to the police. So, and while in terms of the increasing numbers coming forward to our court system, while that may be attributed to a greater willingness to victims to come forward, nonetheless, we know there's a huge issue about under-reporting. So the confidence of victims in our justice system is imperative, and building their confidence. And that's why we need to be having a debate, first and foremost, of substance. And that's why this government has been focused on improving our laws. For example, the Forensic Medical Services legislation, which enables victims to come forward to have to be examined and to be able to log their evidence while they, you know, perhaps get support with advocacy services that the government supports with. Perhaps support with Rape Crisis Scotland, another organisation that we support, so that when it is right for them, they can come forward and make their complaint when they choose to do so. But again, there is always more to do, and I very much look forward to engaging the Member as we embark on our journey, I hope our shared journey, with regards to the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill.
Question number three, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
To ask the Scottish Government what support is in place for disabled children and young people navigating the justice system.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, a range of supports is available. This includes assistance with physical access to court, support with communication and procedural adjustments for giving evidence. We have also introduced advocacy in the children's hearing system, meaning support is available if requested. Operational partners are also exploring how to enhance available support. For example, the Scottish Children's Reporter Administration is working with the Disabled Children Child Protection Network to identify additional needs and vulnerabilities. The recently published Bairnshuis standards set out the inclusive access that children should have, including equitable access to services and reducing barriers faced by disabled children.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Some children with autism and additional support needs find it quite difficult being in varying environments, including child contact centres. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what training is there in contact centres and within the justice system more broadly on autism and disabilities so that staff can pick up when a child is in distress and what processes are in place for when they display significant distress in these circumstances?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Member raises an exceptionally good point, because we know for sure that there is a high prevalence and indeed an over-representation of children with a disability who are having to engage with the justice system, whether that is either as a victim, witness, or in terms of a child that has altercations with the law or interactions with our youth justice system. Our courts and the contact services have a number of obligations, not least with the Equality Act, with GIRFECT, and they need to acknowledge that disability comes in many forms over and above physical disability. And I will write to her with some of the specifics in and around neurodiversity, but I can assure her that in terms of contact centres and the court system as a whole, that it is a very live matter.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. The introduction of the Children Care and Justice Scotland Bill is very welcome in terms of developing age-appropriate care and justice that places the rights, safety and well-being of children at its core. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what steps are being taken to include the voices of children and young people with disabilities and who have navigated the justice system in the development of the legislation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the views of children and young people have been integral to shaping the legislation that the member refers to. Engagement with individuals and groups with experience of both the justice and the hearing systems. That has included our hearings, our voice, STAR, Youth Justice Voices, North Lanarkshire Promise Team, participation group today, not tomorrow, and all of that took place ahead of the bill being introduced to Parliament. We have also worked with Children and Young People's Centre for Justice and the Scottish Youth Parliament to carry out open and targeted sessions with children and young people. And the Youth Parliament, What Takes Your Survey, generated 243 responses from children and young people, and a full equality impact assessment was also published alongside the bill.
Question number four, Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to Police Scotland's latest quarterly performance report, which found that there were 1,928 recorded crimes of online child sexual abuse during 2022-23.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Police Scotland report shows that it is vital to prevent and tackle this complex type of abuse. We are committed to securing the online safety of children and young people, which is why we are taking a range of actions, including funding third sector organisations involved in safeguarding, preventing and responding to child sexual abuse and exploitation, and delivering campaigns aimed at parents and carers to keep children and young people safe online. And we have also revised the National Child Protection Guidance to support local areas to develop effective, evidence-based responses to child sexual abuse and exploitation.
Megan Gallagher.
Detective Chief Superintendent Sam Faulds, Head of Public Protection and Police Scotland's National Child Abuse Investigation Unit, said, "Behind every image of abuse shared online is a child. These images are viewed and shared thousands, if not potentially millions of times around the world. This is a horrific trade in trauma and misery." I think this is an extremely powerful statement. Yet all too often we see that these crimes are not punished severely enough. The Scottish Sentencing Council has confirmed that a person caught in possession of indecent images would likely attract a community sentence despite public opinion favouring a lengthy prison sentence. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, will she commit to publishing data so that the public are aware of the reality of sentencing in these cases?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, members in this chamber are well aware of the role and function of the Scottish Sentencing Council, and they also have a statutory duty to publish guidance in and around the approach and advice they give to independent members of the judiciary regarding different types of offences. Core to this is the risk, and in particular the risk to children, and I would encourage the member when reviewing guidance or the work done by the Scottish Sentencing Council that to look at it all in the round, because there is further guidance coming out in relation to sexual offending, for example. She is right to articulate the seriousness of these matters. It is a growing issue, and I think this member and other members are right to focus on this and to champion it. In terms of actions taken by the Scottish Government, I believe we have successfully engaged with the UK Government with respect to the Online Safety Bill. The point she makes about public engagement is very important, and I would point to the work we do on the Parent Club website. Information for parents in this is absolutely critical, and I would also point to the important work that the Gartcosh Crime Campus does in this regard in terms of detecting this crime in the first place.
Question number seven, Pauline McNeill.
To
to ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with Police Scotland regarding action to tackle the reported rise of online child sex abuse.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as set out in my earlier answer to Megan Gallagher, protecting children from online harm is a key priority. The Scottish Government is a member of Police Scotland's multi-agency group on preventing online child sexual abuse, which meets quarterly to discuss technological advancements in tackling abuse, data gathering, improvements in support for victims and other key activities delivered by our partners. We also continue to work with Police Scotland and the Crown Office to identify opportunities to strengthen legislation in this area.
Pauline McNeill.
A BBC investigation found that paedophiles are using artificial intelligence technology to create and sell lifelike child sexual abuse material online. Shockingly, accessing images by paying subscriptions to accounts on mainstream content sharing sites such as Patreon. An investigation found that Patreon accounts offering AI-generated photorealistic obscene images of children for sale with different levels of pricing depending on the type of material requested. Really quite shocking. Can the Cabinet Secretary give some considerations to whether anything can be done within the devolved competence, but also what is being done to work alongside the UK Government to ensure that these tech companies are held to account and that such images found on their sites can be taken down and eradicated for good?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm aware that the Criminal Justice Committee heard some very illuminating, interesting evidence on this, particularly in relation to what is described as non-real images. And we, as a result of that, and actually the member's previous question, I think just 3 weeks ago, we have been engaging with the police and the Crown Office, as I say in my answer, to ensure that there aren't any gaps within Scots law. In terms of internet and the regulations, while the police could not themselves remove images from the internet, but they can report illegal content to Internet Watch Foundation. As I said to Ms Gallagher earlier, I think we have worked well with the UK Government with respect to the online safety bill, but I want to reassure the member that this is a very live issue because it is a very real and growing problem.
Stephanie Callaghan.
Online child sex abuse and exploitation requires the most serious response, so the actions set out by the Cabinet Secretary to tackle this are welcome. Can the Cabinet Secretary say any more about steps being taken to help children and young people themselves to recognise the signs of online harms, including child sex abuse and exploitation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the safety and wellbeing of our children and young people is of paramount importance, and for all the reasons outlined by the member and others, we are extremely concerned by the ongoing rise of online child sexual abuse. In each of the last 6 years, £14 million core funding has gone to the third sector to strengthen early intervention and prevention efforts to better protect children and young people from abuse, including sexual abuse. We will also continue our commitments across various policy areas to support action to tackle child sexual abuse and exploitation, including work to engage the public and raise awareness about the dangers of online abuse.
Question number five, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service faces, quote, insufficient resource to meet statutory and policy obligations, end quote, due to budget cuts.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as a government, we have a strong track record of investment in the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, with £13 million of additional funding provided in 23-24 in recognition of the pressures of increased case workloads and complexity, pay parity and COVID recovery costs. Its budget is now more than 50% higher than at the start of the last Parliament.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for that response, but in the recently reviewed Executive Board minutes, where it states the current risk score is at red level 16, resource reflects the money that the government has placed in the hands of the Crown Office, and this is clearly inadequate. So what does the government say to those victims, witnesses and next of kin who are waiting longer for cases, where there are more miscarriages of justice and errors, and we have failed cases because suspected criminals are not prosecuted in time? Is this the responsibility of the Crown Office or this government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm quite sure it has not escaped the member that while the block grant to the Scottish Government has reduced in real terms by 5%, I have also indicated the long-term increase to the Crown Office in my original answer under the administration of this Government. If we take, for example, that £105 million was invested 2014-15, the budget of the Crown Office now sits at £196 million. In terms of the current financial year, they had a 10% uplift. Nonetheless, I do certainly appreciate the impact of inflation and rising complexity of needs. But the additional resource that this government has provided has also enabled the Crown Office to increase full-time equivalent staff working under them. And obviously it's an important matter and I appreciate the member's interest in this, and he will of course be aware of the usual means in which all portfolios come together, in which Parliament comes together to scrutinise the priorities but also the choices that we all collectively have to make.
Bob Dorris.
Presiding Officer, I've been making representations to the Crown Office direct to the Lord Advocate raising concerns over the handling of a Crown case against my constituent's daughter. A case finally dropped after 30 months. I wish to see an independent review of the entire case, something I've written to the Cabinet Secretary about. Will the Cabinet Secretary meet with me to discuss these concerns and my suggestion?
I would suggest perhaps that this question with requirements of standing orders is at odds with a substantive question. And I'm going to call Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Taxpayers have been hit with a £51 million compensation bill for the Crown Office's malicious prosecutions linked to Rangers Football Club, with the Crown being bailed out by the Scottish Government with this money. However, I've since established that these cases have cost another £6 million in legal fees. So given the Crown's perilous financial predicament, can the Cabinet Secretary confirm if that money came from the Government or from the Crown's regular budget?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I will perhaps ask Mr Finlay to submit that question to the Crown Office. I'll perhaps even do that on his behalf. But I mean, ultimately, the funding that comes to my portfolio in justice and the funding that goes to the Crown Office as a separate portfolio at the end of the day is all taxpayers' money.
Question number six, Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on any meetings that it's had with stakeholders regarding the legal age of marriage.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've now spoken to around 25 organisations representing a number of interests, including ending forced marriage and violence against women and girls. There is a range of views. Increasing the minimum age can be argued to increase safeguards, but can also be seen as removing young people's right to marry or enter into a civil partnership. We also need to consider that young people acquire a number of important rights at the age of 16. I'm meeting Pauline Latham, the MP, after the summer, and as Claire Baker may know, she promoted legislation at Westminster to raise the age of marriage in England and Wales.
Claire Baker.
I thank the Minister for that response, and I do welcome the meetings that are taking place, but I'm unclear as to why the Scottish Government is not prepared to undertake a full public consultation on this issue. The UNCRC committee is clear that the age of marriage should be raised to 18, and under the UN Sustainable Development Goals, members around the world, including the UK, have pledged to end all marriage under 18 by 2030. As the Minister has recognised, in England and Wales, the change in law is coming into force in February. We have now know that in Northern Ireland, following a public consultation, the overwhelming majority of respondents were in favour of raising the age to 18, and the intention is to bring legislation forward once Stormont is fully operational. So is the Scottish Government really willing to remain out of step with other Western countries and ignore the international conventions on women's rights and on children by failing to take action on raising the age in Scotland to 18?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The committee's recommendation will be fully taken into account as we gather views from stakeholders and consider our next steps. Our approach will help ensure that we properly assess the potential impacts of any changes, and this, as this Parliament would expect. If we do take forward a full public consultation, we want this to include robust evidence. If we decide to issue a public consultation, the earliest this could be done is 2024, and clearly any legislation after that would depend on the results of the consultation and the availability of time in this Parliament.
Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One concern with the legal age of marriage is around the potential vulnerability of young people to forced marriage. Can I ask the Minister what protections and safeguards are currently in place for those who may be vulnerable to or at risk of forced marriage?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Forced marriage has a devastating impact on those affected and can be a form of honour-based violence. There are protections in both the criminal and the civil law. Forcing someone into marriage is a criminal offence. Forced marriage protection orders can also be sought from the civil court, and breach of an order is a criminal offence. From the 30th of November, these protections will extend to forced civil partnerships. No one should have to endure forced marriages, and we fund the Scottish National Domestic Abuse and Forced Marriage Helpline to provide advice and support, and help is available 24 hours a day on 0800 027 1234.
Thank you. That concludes Justice and Home Affairs portfolio questions. We move on to education and skills. And at question number one, sorry, I'll allow a moment for front benches to reorganise. We move to education and skills, and at question number one, I call Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the role that the third sector plays in supporting education and developing skills.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
The Scottish Government recognises that the third sector plays a vitally important role in the supporting of the delivery of education and skills provision at local, regional and national level. We continue to provide direct financial support to a wide range of third sector organisations providing those services, many of which are supporting individuals with additional barriers to positive destinations.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that there are lessons learned, best learned outside the classroom, that can have a huge impact inside the classroom, specifically around developing of confidence, resilience and aspiration, especially for those pupils who find the standard educational environment difficult. With that in mind, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that underfunding the third sector is a false economy? And what will she do to ensure the third sector are adequately funded to ensure a full and broad educational offer?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Whittle for his question. I know he takes a keen interest in relation to the role that sport plays in education, and I share, I think, a number of the points that he has made this afternoon in relation to that learning outside the classroom. I think it's important to say that we do provide a wide range of funding to a number of different third sector organisations that provide services in the education sector. We also, for example, through pupil equity funding, allow head teachers to use some of that funding directly to include the third sector in the provision of education. But I think more broadly, the member's point around the opportunities for working with the third sector is an important one, and it's one that certainly I would seek to build on as we move forward with our wider reforms in relation to school reform.
Can I just confirm, Ms Mackay, if you are seeking a supplementary? Thank you. We'll move on to question number two, Michael Mara.
The Government what its response is to reported concerns that prolonging phase three of the Learning Estate Investment Programme will further delay the delivery of a primary school in the Western Gateway area of Dundee.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
I understand that local authorities are keen to get clarity on phase three of the Learning Estate Investment Programme. I recently visited the East End Community Campus project in Dundee of last week, and I know about the difference that LEAP funding will make in that area, particularly with the amalgamation there of two schools in that community. Scottish Government officials wrote to all councils back in March to explain that consideration about these projects would form part of phase three. That was still ongoing at that time. That set out that further time was needed to look at the scope of phase three, particularly taking into account the impact of market volatility on current projects and price increases accordingly. Since then, our medium-term financial strategy, published in May, has also highlighted that our top priority needs to be to ensure that Scottish finances remain on a sustainable trajectory. These are big decisions, and it's important we get them right. However, I remain committed to announcing the successful phase three projects as soon as possible.
Michael Mara.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. The Western Gateway Primary School is scheduled to open in 2026, August of that year, and families will have been waiting over a decade, Presiding Officer. It does require 50% funding from the Scottish Government, and I know that the Cabinet Secretary has highlighted the difference that LEAP projects will make to their local areas. Does she appreciate the real concern in that community that the further delays that she announced on the 1st of June and that she's re-announced today may put that opening date at risk, the plans that young people and their families have to make for their futures that are being put at risk as a result?
Cabinet Secretary.
I very much don't want those plans to be put at risk, and I recognise the member's interest in this. I think it is worthwhile pointing out that we have announced LEAP Phase 2 projects in Dundee in December 2020 and included, of course, in Dundee City Council's priority project, a new East End community campus, as I outlined, replacing Braeview Academy and Craigie High School. Dundee City Council also put forward a new Western Gateway Primary School, as the member's alluded to, and it's as its priority project for the LEAP Phase 3 funding. And, of course, we will announce the Phase 3 projects very soon. I do recognise some of the challenges this presents in relation to uncertainty. I hope to bring that certainty very soon to a number of different local authorities, of course, who have also submitted bids. The member will understand some of the real financial pressure the government is struggling with at the current time, and I want to be absolutely certain that we are delivering on as many schools as possible to ensure that we can improve on the learning environments for our young people. And I think the LEAP project and our approach to school funding has been really innovative, working with local authorities, but recognising, of course, that they have statutory responsibility for the delivery of education locally.
Question number 3 is not lodged. Question number 4, Ivan McKee.
To ask the Scottish Government which parts of the independent review of the skills delivery landscape it plans to implement.
Minister Graham Day.
Through our engagement in the Purpose and Principles for Post-School Education, Research and Skills published today, it is evident that there is a necessity for the reforms that James Withers outlines. The initial priorities published alongside Purpose and Principles are clear that we accept the basis of his recommendations on language skills planning, employer engagement, funding and pathways reform. How we implement reform across the education system, including in the context of the independent review of qualifications and assessment published last week, will be determined by our further discussions with stakeholders over the coming weeks and months.
Ivan McKee.
The Withers Review highlights the need for industry engagement and the critical importance of work-based learning apprenticeships. However, the Minister will have seen commentary from Paul Sheeran, Chief Executive of Scottish Engineering, that the proposals in the review run the risk of taking us further away from those goals. Can I ask how will the Government ensure that employers and businesses are fully engaged and work-based learning is given the importance it deserves to ensure Scotland has the skills it needs to take maximum advantage of the enormous industrial opportunities before us?
Minister.
I noted Paul Sheeran's comments. However, I believe the Withers proposals, when linked in with the work taking place in educational reform, will take us forward. I absolutely recognise the importance of employer engagement and am committed to ensuring that our reformed learning system meets the needs of employers of all sizes across Scotland. That's why the Government will be working with a range of employers and representatives to understand their views and perspectives as we consider next steps toward implementing change. How we implement reform across the education sector, it will be determined by that engagement.
Pam Gosnell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Keys to the establishment of a successful post-school learning system will be a measuring progress towards it. Measuring progress is something that the SNP have often struggled with, preferring to mask their failures under the guise of spin. But we need an honest assessment so problems can be addressed before spiralling into administrative quagmire, and that we see before us today. So can the Minister explain how progress will be measured?
Minister.
President Officer, it's a disappointingly negative contribution to an incredibly important debate that's taking place. Of course, progress towards achieving what we set out to achieve will be important. But right now, the focus of everyone is, or should be, on shaping a skills and post-schools education landscape that meets the needs of our learners for the future. And that's what the government's focused on.
Daniel Johnson.
Thank you. And I'd echo Ivan McKee's comments in that the Withers Review, I think, was important in terms of the functional outcomes such as the parity of esteem, embedding SCQF and flexibility through measures such as digital skills. But I think the documents released today focus more on structure. Indeed, I think the removal of funding and skills planning, I think, asked big questions of the future of SDS and what its status will be. So given that there are 1,500 people employed by SDS, when will we get clarity about whether SDS will continue? And indeed, will those jobs continue? And given the scale and impact of what is being proposed, would it not have been better to have a statement or even a debate on this rather than releasing the details through correspondence with the committee convener?
Minister.
Presiding officer, I should say that we also met yesterday with opposition spokespersons on this very subject. I recognise Daniel Johnson's interest in this. With regard to the recommendations, we've tried today to give a degree of certainty where we can. So in relation to SDS, we've provided a degree of that. We're also very much aware about the concerns of the employees, and that's why we will move as quickly as we can to provide in the certainty that they will require. I do think that if you read both documents together, you'll see a direction of travel. We will provide more detail post-recess, Presiding Officer.
Question number five, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what it's doing to assist local authorities with the recruitment of teachers.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
Local councils are responsible for the recruitment and deployment of their staff, and they have autonomy to provide incentives to their area because it is they and not central government who employ our teachers. I will continue to engage directly with COSLA on this issue. However, the Scottish Government is committed to supporting the recruitment of more teachers, and we are providing £145.5 million in this year's budget to protect increased teacher numbers and also support staff across all local authorities. The retention of teachers is absolutely key, and undoubtedly the historic pay settlement reached earlier this year will go some way to achieving that aspiration and underlining this Government's commitment to our teachers.
Rona Mackay.
I thank the current Secretary for that answer. A constituent is concerned that many probationary teachers, including her son, completed his probationary period at school in Eastern Bartonshire and received an excellent report from the head teacher. However, when it came to interviewing for vacant posts, he was competing with newly qualified teachers with no probationary experience, and he and other colleagues lost out on a job. I understand some councils have positive discrimination in place to benefit those who have successfully completed their probation year within that authority. Does the minister agree that experience as a probationary teacher should be taken into account, and that lack of security is turning away many people desperate for a vacation in teaching?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think teaching is a really attractive career choice for many people, and indeed Scottish teachers, as we know, following the pay deal that I outlined in my original response, are the best paid in the UK. But I do expect local councils who employ our teachers to recruit teaching staff in an open and a fair and transparent manner. And indeed, I discussed this matter with COSLA only this morning. The teacher induction scheme is funded, of course, by the Scottish Government, and that gives a one-year probationary placement to allow teachers the opportunity to meet the standard for full registration. But we have never provided a guarantee of future employment with a particular local authority. It's always been the responsibility of local councils to recruit and employ their teachers based on local needs and circumstances. And I know that when I completed my own probation year many, many years ago now, there was a deeply competitive jobs market at that time, and people had to move to find work. Now, I accept that not everyone will be able to do that, for example, if they have a young family. To that end, we are providing councils, as I mentioned in my original response, with that additional funding in this year's budget, particularly focused on protecting increased teacher numbers. I discussed this, as I mentioned, with COSLA earlier today, but also with the General Teaching Council for Scotland, and I look forward to working with COSLA on this very issue, recognising some of the national challenge here at the current time.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In any job, promoting a safe, secure work environment with good and fair working conditions is undoubtedly a pull factor in terms of recruitment. Teachers and trade unions have told us that heavy workload and a lack of non-contact time is impacting on wellbeing, and the national discussion was crystal clear that the Government must implement its commitment to increase non-contact time. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's confirmation that the Government remain committed to doing so, and can the Cabinet Secretary update Parliament today on a timetable for implementation?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the Member for this question, and of course she raised it with me a number of weeks ago now, I think in one of our education debates or statements, I can't recall exactly the one, but I do very much remain committed to looking at this issue, of course, with our partners in the Scottish Negotiating Committee for Teachers. She mentioned workload, and she also mentioned class contact in relation to, and I think both factors play into how we take forward some of the key reforms coming from the national discussion, but also the outputs from the Hayward Review. I will be commissioning an external piece of work which will consider and bring together a range of factors, including effective local and national teacher workforce planning, pupil-teacher ratios, and also the projected decline in the number of school-aged children in Scotland, to help inform effective and evidence-informed workforce planning, which I think is hugely important. we do need to look at those issues holistically, because certain issues in certain local authorities won't exist everywhere. And we need to ensure that we have an education workforce in place that enables us to progress our commitments on reducing class teachers' contact time, on raising attainment overall, closing the poverty-related attainment gap, and on improving additional support for learning, whilst also delivering maximum value for money.
Willie Rennie.
The Cabinet Secretary does know there is a significant problem with unemployment and underemployment, particularly with primary teachers, and this is across the country. Now that she's been in post for a few weeks, has she got an understanding about how we can tackle this, including dealing with the supply? Are we training, in other words, too many teachers into the system, and therefore how are we going to tackle the high level of unemployment within teaching?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Rennie for his question. He highlights some of the issues we face in relation to primary recruitment, which I'm well cited on. I've discussed this matter with the Scottish Education Council, and School Leaders Scotland have been taking forward some work on this. They presented to the Scottish Education Council on this a number of weeks ago now. I'm very keen to work more broadly with the General Teaching Council for Scotland on this issue, recognising some of the issues that he spoke to. And I think it's hugely important we do have a better understanding of the national picture, because some of the issues that exist in the local authority, which he and I represent, won't exist, for example, in Dundee City Council, which takes a very different approach to teacher recruitment. I'm really keen that I work with COSLA on this. I met with COSLA, as I mentioned in my response to Pam Duncan-Glancy this morning, and we take that forward in partnership, of course, recognising that local authorities are fundamentally the employers of our teachers.
Question number six, Russell Finlay.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the independent review into the planning for Dargavel Primary School.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government are taking the capacity issues at Dargavel Primary School very seriously, and officials met with Renfrewshire Council very recently to discuss the independent review report that was published earlier this month. Renfrewshire Council have accepted all of the report's recommendations, I'm advised. The Council has issued an unreserved apology to parents and carers and has committed to working with them to deliver on the report's recommendations and, importantly, I think, to restore public trust. Although this is a matter for Renfrewshire Council, I also met yesterday with the Primary School Parent Council, a representative from, and also with Neil Bibby, MSP, to hear their concerns directly.
Russell Finlay.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The report is damning. It describes Renfrewshire Council's planning of Dargavel in a quote, woefully inadequate and grossly incompetent. For years, parents voiced concerns that the school was too small, yet the report confirms that not a single complaint was ever given proper scrutiny. And the Council's approach was, and I quote, the complaints were wrong, the Council is right. But it turns out the Council was wrong and the parents were right. So the Scottish Government now step in, start from scratch and ensure local pupils do not pay the price for this Dargavel debacle. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. I think he raises a number of really important points. I discussed this at length yesterday in my meeting with Mr Bibby and with the representative from the Parent Council. And I think some of the issue here, of course, relates to accountability, as the member has alluded to. And that accountability is ultimately for the local authority. He asks if I am able, as Cabinet Secretary, to step in. I have asked my officials to raise this issue directly with the Chief Planner in case there's any evidence that she can offer the Council on that matter. More broadly, I've asked for advice from officials in relation to any support we might be able to give the local authority as they move forward with the challenges that are inherent with the result of this poor decision-making, I have to say, in relation to the school build itself. And I commit to working closely with any interested MSPs on this issue, because it's a huge issue locally. I know it's been really difficult for parents in particular, who, of course, have been raising these concerns over a number of months, if not years. It is important, though, that the local council, who have statutory responsibility for the delivery of education, now work to rebuild trust. I've committed to working with the local council on this matter in the summer recess to talk to them directly about what more support the Scottish Government might be able to provide in that respect. But I do recognise this is a very challenging issue locally. I will do all that I can as Cabinet Secretary to help provide some support, but it is fundamentally a matter for Renfrewshire Council.
Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Renfrewshire Council has been found to be incompetent, arrogant and amateur, and the Cabinet Secretary has heard from parents directly that they have lost all confidence in the Council. £160 million wasted, yet nobody has been held accountable. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree there must be accountability here, and only a full and an independent investigation into the Dargavel debacle will command public confidence? And will the Minister also seriously consider the request from parents to fully consider the case for an independent and robust oversight of Renfrewshire Council's future delivery of Dargavel education provision?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Bibby for his question. We had a really productive, I think, meeting yesterday. It was very helpful. And I think the points he makes about a lack of confidence in the Council are very important, and on accountability. Of course, there has been this independent inquiry. I know there are a number of challenges potentially with how that's landed with parents locally. I think it's important now as Cabinet Secretary I meet with the Council. I've agreed to do so with Mr Bibby during summer recess to hear from them directly moving forward on that call from parents for an independent and robust approach to governance. I give him an absolute assurance that whatever I am able to do within the confines of being Cabinet Secretary for Education, I will provide support in relation to Scottish Government officials, recognising again, as I said, I think in my response to Mr Finlay, this is ultimately a matter for the local authority, but he will have my support in all that I am able to do within the powers at my disposal.
Question number 7, Rose McCall.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its progress towards meeting its 2030 target for widening access to university admission.
Minister Graham Day.
General Officer, we are committed to ensuring learners from our most disadvantaged areas are supported into universities. Last year, over 16% of first-degree entrants studying full-time were from deprived areas, meaning we have fulfilled the first target set by the Commission on Widening Access, and credit to our universities for that. We should be immensely proud of the progress we've made collectively on widening participation. But of course, we recognise that there is more work to do, and we'll continue to work with the sectors and the Commissioner for Fair Access to make further progress towards our targets.
Rose McCall.
I thank the Minister for the response. Recommendation 31 of the Commission on Widening Access report published in 2016 stated that the Scottish Government and the Scottish Funding Council should develop a consistent and robust set of measures to identify access students for 2018. So 7 years later, universities are still using the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, which only identifies neighbourhood areas resulting in a postcode lottery. And stakeholders are extremely concerned that if action is not taken now, then the 2030 target will not be met. So can I ask the Minister why the Scottish Government has failed so far to deliver on the promise for robust measures from 2016, and how this failure will impact the 2030 target?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, Rose McCall asks a legitimate question, though I would refer her to the fact that we have met the initial target. Now, I accept that to create a truly fair system, it's important for us to fully identify those who face the greatest barriers to entering university. And the Commission's final report made clear that SIMD is the best measure we currently have to support our work on access. However, we recognise the importance of identifying all of those who face socio-economic disadvantages, including in rural areas. And that's why we have established a working group to consider what other measures could be used alongside SIMD to support our work on fair access. The Access Data Short Life Working Group is currently due to report its recommendations to ministers in September of this year, and will continue to work with the sectors and the Commissioner to ensure we are best supporting those who need it.
Keith Brown.
We should, of course, never be complacent when it comes to widening access, but the numbers don't lie. Higher education student stats show that since 2006-07, there's been an increase of 31.4% in the number of Scotland-domiciled full-time first-degree entrants to our universities, and we're seeing more from the most deprived areas actually going to universities. Does the Minister agree with me that the party which introduced free university education by scrapping the graduate endowment needs no lessons from the Tories when it comes to widening access?
Minister.
Officer, indeed, and I agree that we should be proud of the progress we've made. And again, I pay tribute to the universities for the work they've done. We've seen an impressive 41% increase in the most deprived students entering university since we accepted the recommendations of the Commission. Access to university should be based on the ability to learn, not the ability to pay. That is what this government continues to deliver.
Question number 8, Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to end the marking and assessment boycott in Scottish universities.
Minister Graham Day.
Then, officer, whilst the Scottish Government has no direct role in resolving industrial disputes in the further and higher education sectors, we are clear that we expect trade unions and employers to work together to resolve issues around pay, terms and conditions. In recent weeks, I've met with the trade unions and employers and have urged them to engage in constructive and meaningful dialogue in pursuit of a resolution of these disputes.
Sandesh Gulhani.
Minister, students from universities across Scotland, and in particular the University of Glasgow, through no fault of their own, are graduating with unclassified degrees. I have constituents writing to me worried about their futures. Students feel let down and betrayed as they are being used as collateral damage in a dispute between lecturers and universities. The Minister must stand up for students who have been abandoned in this dispute. What guarantees can the Minister make to ensure every university student will receive fully marked coursework and an accurate degree classification by the end of the summer?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I agree that the students find themselves in a situation that's no fault of their own. I also know that the universities are working extremely hard to try and resolve matters. But in the context of the industrial dispute, it is deeply regrettable that individuals are suffering as a result of the boycott. And that's why I pressed our Scottish universities to push UCEA to get back around the table and for progress not just on pay, but issues such as gender pay gap and casualisation to be made. Now, I understand the Scottish Committee of UCEA met the unions just this week, and whilst that was not part of the formal negotiation process, I welcome the fact that they are at very least talking. But if the member is as keen as I am to have matters resolved, perhaps he can encourage his colleagues in the UK Government to be asking English universities to be directing UCEA to reopen talks with no preconditions, because these are UK-wide negotiations.
John Mason.
Thank you. As I understand it, universities are independent institutions, and of course we all want to see a fair settlement. But I wonder if the Minister would agree with me that it would actually be damaging for universities' worldwide reputation if the government started interfering in day-to-day matters.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I think the role of government is to work constructively with the institutions and with the trade unions to try and encourage resolution. Because Sandesh Gulhani is correct. None of us want to see our students adversely affected in this way.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a brief pause before we move on to the next item of business.